First, we are crossing to our nearest neighbour, or our near neighbour, New Zealand. Pacific Island Mental Health for Oceania, igniting communities, creating change. We have the wonderful clinical psychologist, Dr. Monique Faleafa. She is the founding chief executive of LEVAR, a national NGO focused on Pacific people's well-being. They specialise in Pacific approaches to suicide prevention, mental health, addiction workforce development, violence prevention, disability support services, public health, cultural competency training, and holistic wellbeing. This is, they have a large remit, and Monique is an incredible leader in New Zealand, but she also actually comes here quite a bit too, because she's working with the rugby league in Sydney to cultivate a wellbeing process there, which she might touch on along the way too, because I'm quite interested in that. She's on many boards. She serves on various Ministry of Health advisory committees. She was the 2016 member of the New Zealand Order of Merit. She was given that award and was a finalist in the Westpac Women of Influence Awards. And please welcome Monique.
Kia ora koutou katoa toa from the Cook Islands. It's a country under administration of New Zealand, and Cook Islanders are born New Zealand citizens. Malolele from the Kingdom of Tonga, our only monarchy in the Pacific, and who this week we mourn the death of Her Majesty Queen Mother Halevalu Mata'aho. Whakalova lahi atu from the island of Niue, commonly known as The Rock, and Maloni from the coral atolls of Tokelau. Whakatālofa atu from Tuvalu, the fourth smallest country in the world. Nisan Bulivanaka from the Republic of Fiji, part of Melanesia rather than Polynesia, which includes Vanuatu, Solomon Islands, Papua New Guinea, New Caledonia and West Papua. And as an ancestor of Oceania, I too wish to acknowledge the traditional owners of this land on which we meet, the Gadigal people of the Eora Nation, and pay my respect to their elders past, present, and emerging. And from Samoa, the centre of the universe where I'm from, the people of the sun, fa'amalo ato ilipaia malamamalo malava or alfeelin na yaso. And I really acknowledge the fantastic leadership of the organisers of this meeting, the New South Wales Mental Health Commission, for the invitation. Tālofa, whaatālofa atu, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā tātou katoa. So Oceania really covers a huge part of planet Earth. The Pacific Ocean, our Moana, is the largest body of water on the planet, and it's our Pacific Ocean that doesn't separate us but binds us. It's our life force that connects Australasia, Micronesia, Polynesia and Melanesia, and many of us connect with our Pacific ancestors, who are really well known as skilled seafaring navigators, using the earth, the sun, the sea and the stars to really navigate uncharted waters and discover new lands and new possibilities. And many of us in the room here today are migrants or children of migrants. At some point through our generations, many of us are children of some migration. And when we look at our forefathers that migrated, we can see that in the face of so much change, they must have had so much resiliency and so much courage and so much hope. Hope for a better life, not just for them, but for their children and for generations to come, to flourish into the future. But some would say that we're not quite achieving the hopes of our forefathers. Today we have huge inequalities and inequities, decades of disparity that really prevent our nations as a whole to collectively flourish. In New Zealand, Pacific Island people fall under the poverty line. We have high unemployment, low achievement in education, high crime rates, high levels of Pacific youth not in education, employment or training, and I could go on. But I look at Australia with interest at the moment because we're really starting to see some similar patterns that mirror New Zealand 35 or 40 years ago. The Pacific population in New Zealand is around 300,000, and we've been in New Zealand about 150 years and have a strong cultural identity with New Zealand as well. But Australia has now 280,000 Pacific people, mostly living in New South Wales and Queensland, and that kind of just happened overnight, that growth. So it would make sense to sort of front foot some of the issues that we're starting to see and predict what might happen over the next decade if we continue along the status quo in Australia in terms of mental health and wellbeing. So in New Zealand, in terms of health, it's not surprising that Pacific people feature disproportionately in lower life expectancy, poorer health outcomes, and long-term chronic conditions. And in terms of mental illness, we have a rate higher than the New Zealand population, but very low access to services. And it's mostly our young people who carry the burden of mental health challenges, particularly in the severe forms of mental illness. But a key enabler for reducing health inequalities and increasing access rates is developing a really great workforce. And that's where LIVAR comes into two areas. We try and ensure that our mental health and addictions workforce really reflects the communities that we serve. And we look at enhancing the cultural responsiveness of services. So I've got a quick explainer reel just to describe some of our work.
For generations, our people thrived on small islands in the world's biggest ocean. Our elders chose to look for more opportunities and a better life for those to come. They looked to New Zealand. At first, there was a period of economic growth and we helped New Zealand industries grow. But soon after, we were blamed for many of the country's problems. Despite all, Pasifika have survived in New Zealand, proud of our culture, contributing positively to New Zealand's national identity, economy, and society. We've had to deal with decades of disparity, and Pasifika youth especially face big issues growing up. That's where LIVAR comes in. Our purpose is simple, to support Pasifika families and communities to unleash their full potential. We achieve it in different ways, leading New Zealand's first national Pasifika suicide prevention program to end suicide for both Māori and Pasifika communities, growing the Pasifika health workforce so communities connect with the right support, enhancing cultural competency so workers can better engage with Pasifika people so that we get the best care possible for our families, supporting our young leaders to embrace our cultural values in our work so that our future leaders carry the wisdom of the past, advocating for Pasifika people with disabilities so that they can access the right support and can live the lives they choose, and equipping our workforce and communities with relevant tools, resources and information. Our approach balances community, cultural and clinical expertise and is based on the concept of VA, the relational space. VIVAR values our relationships and we work in collaboration with our partners. Our young people are succeeding despite issues outside of their control, but there's more work to do. We know we can do better.
Imagine a world where Pacifica young people are resilient and prosperous, where we all have safe, healthy and respectful relationships. And when our young people do need help, they get the right support at the right time. LIVAR is working on building this world right now. Come join us. Let's work together.
LIVAR, igniting communities, creating change.
Thank you. There was some discussion yesterday in our plenary that we really need to invest in culturally led organisations in order to grow the capacity and capability of leadership in terms of diversity in our workforce. And so I'm really honoured that and grateful that LIVAR exists today because we've had those magnificent disruptive leaders to pave the way for us. And those leaders have really symbolically and strategically said that solutions for suicide for Pacific or for problems that we have really lie within our own communities. We have a proverb in Samoa. It goes, E fofo le alamea le alamea. And what it refers to is a starfish that if you stand on it, it's poisonous and it can be fatal. But if you turn the starfish upside down, the antidote is in the undercarriage. And so you put that on the wound and it sucks the toxic poisons out. And what it's referring to, in a very long-winded way, is that the solutions to our problems lie within us. Three of our key design principles are what I call three C's, and all of our work is clinically sound, so it's very evidence-informed, and where we can't find the evidence, particularly for working with Pacific communities, you know, we just look at best practice and practice-based evidence. We make sure it's culturally robust, so we have a large council of elders who are the guardians of our work, and we work with a council of youth who just keep us real, really. And then it's really community driven. So community part is making sure that the communities that we're working alongside are empowered to have an equal voice in what we do. And we've coined the hashtag collaboration, and it's become a design principle of ours because we really don't kill time with too much rhetoric, but we just work with partners that have a shared purpose and a shared response with calls to action. In fact, our name Levar was gifted to us by our Pacific communities, which in many Pacific languages literally means the space between, but it refers to not open space or expanse, but space that connects, space that relates. So it's referring to relationships, and those relationships are sacred. And it's not just with people, it's with the land and the sea and the stars and the sky and the environment, our ancestors and also the dead. So the VA, that name that was given to us, really suits that our holistic approach to mental health and well-being. So traditionally that encompasses mental, physical, social and spiritual well-being. And in terms of our 3C approach today, I figured I could just zoom in on a couple of things that might support the cultural relevancy of your work. And the first one I want to talk about was cultural competency, and the second one was around working with Pacific young people. Feel free to tweet away. My team in South Auckland are watching social media right now, so let's go gangbusters and make me look good. Cheers. So internationally, the field of cultural competence has really emerged as a strategy to reduce disparities in access to and quality of healthcare. And really clear links have been made between cultural competency training and reducing those ethnic disparities. Our Engaging Pacifica Cultural Competency Training Program focuses just on the foundation, knowledge, skills and attitude that's really required to work effectively with Pacific families and communities in mental health services. And we know it's in demand because a recent survey by Te Pau of all adult mental health services in New Zealand has shown that 74% of services have said, yes please, they'd like some cultural competency training. So we've had about 4,000 people through the program, but rather than go through the program and its outcomes, which you can find on our website, I wanted to just talk about four key success factors that we've learnt over the last 6 years. And one of them is having blended learning. It really has maximum impact. So we have three phases. We have a compulsory pre-workshop e-learning module, and we've had some really good evaluation results from that, which are anything online and digital is really easy to measure. And then we have a face-to-face workshop, and that's really where the learner can connect heart and mind. So we get the changes in attitude and the change in and how you apply what they learnt online. And then we have optional follow-up e-learning modules. And that design is really solid. We've had some help from Professor Joseph Betancourt at Harvard, and our program's been acknowledged by the New Zealand Health and Disability Commission and funded by the Ministry of Health. And importantly, it's been mandated by our Pacific communities, who really understand that it's okay to have this knowledge accessible online because it's firmly grounded in traditional values. We just have a very contemporary execution of those values in cyberspace. So here's a quick look at a couple of the optional ethnic-specific online modules.
Oh, my God.
And I really just want to acknowledge Manasi Lua here from Te Pau, who contributed to those online modules significantly. The next success factor for cultural competency training for us has been around cultural authenticity, and really it's a prerequisite. So it might take 15 or 20 minutes to do from your phone, on the train, on the way to work, but each one took us a whole year to develop, because our methodology really empowers community to take ownership, and in fact we gifted all these online modules back to those communities who can use them as they wish. And you know, we talk about fake news. Well, you can actually have fake views in cultural competency. And so we just need to really choose the right cultural competency training programs to upskill our staff. You know, don't look for the flashiest or cheapest. Look at the method, who did it, and at how the program was designed, and then make a judgment call on its authenticity. The next success factor is around responsive systems, and because if we have responsive systems of the skills that we learn in our training, we can enhance the practical application of them. So cultural competency is not just about training individuals, it includes organisations and systems and structures of which we work. In 1 year, we had 10 organisations ask us to tailor a program just for them. And what we found is they really needed to take time to build trust in their local communities that they serve. They just weren't having meaningful engagement, because when we work cross-culturally, we have a saying, you can only travel at the speed of trust. And these are all available on our website if you want to download. It's quite a big document. All of the other systems of cultural organisational cultural competence, like reflected in our governance, our vision, our purpose, HR strategies, policies and procedures and recruitment, they're all brought to life in practice once we have the trust in place. So we ended up writing 9 guidelines for the disability support service sector, and they've had really good uptake in New Zealand. The fourth and final success factor for cultural competency training we found was around being strengths-based. We found that reframing cultural competencies to a strengths-based approach and using a positive lens is really the only way to go, because we could talk about legislation and regulation, all those sector standards that require us to be culturally safe or culturally aware, culturally sensitive or culturally competent. In our work, or we could show you graph after graph after graph after graph of inequitable health outcomes. Or we could show you your company's policies and procedures that tell us how to do it. But that whole approach really is in the deficit model. And what we've found is if we keep doing that, we're just on the back foot and it's hard to see a way forward. So having a strengths-based approach, grounded in positive psychology and coming from an aspirational and forward-thinking paradigm, we pose a question, and this is the question we want to ask in our roundtables today. I think I've got a slide. Yes. What would it look like if culture and care connected in mental health? And I've got some ideas, and then I think we'll go and break out. So I'll just give you a few ideas first. If culture and care connected and mental health, what we'd see is that relationships would become paramount in our work. And I think the minister the other night, the Minister of Mental Health in New South Wales, said, you know, we're looking at people first. It's not about systems and structures. And that's what we mean here. We would see our frontline workers would know how to engage cross-culturally. And it's not just about communication or language or translation or interpretation. It's really about relationships and meaningful engagement. And on an individual level, what we'd see if culture and care connected in mental health, we'd see our staff being really self-reflective in their practice. So they would have a really good understanding of our own culture and how that might impact on others. And that really is, you know, cultural competency in a nutshell, just being really self-aware. On a clinical level, what we'd see if culture and care connected in mental health is that clinicians would integrate that medical model, the principles of biomedicine, with the values and beliefs of our clients or patients. And that is a tricky line to walk, but to us, that's what culture and care looks like when we connect. And from an organisational perspective, what we'd see is that our staff would reflect the diverse populations that we serve. And from a more macro level, sorry, there's one more, everyone would really understand the social determinants of health. So the social, economic and physical environment, such as income, education and housing, and how that all impacts on our mental health. And what we end up seeing, and this is all from 6 years of feedback, is quite tangible and measurable outcomes. What we've seen is that Pacific people would access healthcare services in a really timely manner. At the moment, Pacific people have extremely low access, but when we access, it's at the crisis end of the continuum. It costs the taxpayer $1 a lot more, but more importantly, it costs those families and communities a lot of pain and suffering. So accessing earlier generally means better health outcomes for everyone, but also value for money. We'd also see a lot of reduction in DNA rates, did not attend. That costs us millions and millions of dollars a year. I don't think we've really got that right. But with organisational engagement with communities, we see that DNA rate reduce because people are valuing the service. We'd see Pacific people more satisfied with the quality of the staff and the quality of the service that they get. And we'd also see higher rates of compliance with treatment. That's a really big problem in our Pacific communities. And I use the word compliance because it's really about medication. You know, we all have to get auntie to take her medication because she just doesn't want to take it. But if we understand what it's like to work cross-culturally, we see compliance better. And so overall, we see better quality services and outcomes for all and better value for money. So we're going to, just one thing before we go into the question. You'll see on your table a pen, and if you open the pen, it's a flag, and it has the Pacific greetings on. And I thought, you know, why not just do a bit of cultural competency while I'm here? So before you speak, whoever speaks has to try and say a greeting off that pen, off the flag on the pen. Just give it a go. It's, you know, it's talofa, kia ora, kia rana, nisa mbolivanaka, the hard one, and it's you'll know why it's hard when I say it, whakalofa lahi atu. So, you know, just before you speak, and we're really happy when people give it a go, that as long as we see people trying to pronounce our names and our greetings, we're really happy. I'll hand over to Natasha.
Over to you. So we're over to you, more the point. So we'd like you to discuss this question at your tables. What would it look like if culture and care connected in your organisation? Perhaps it does. Or perhaps you have some challenges around that because you connect with many different cultures. How do you see culture?
All right, so I'll give this a go. Kia orana.
Well done. Kia ora.
So we're Ontario Shores Centre for Mental Health Sciences, a hospital just in outside of Toronto, Ontario, Canada. And we've looked at cultural competence in two levels, and perhaps just a bit of context first. Within our mosaic, we have quite a number of different cultural groups. So there's no dominant cultural group or dominant minority group. So we do have indigenous people. We have people from racial as well as religious and linguistic background. So very, very diverse groups of individuals. And we've worked at it from two perspectives. The first has been what I would call foundational elements. So things like language, making sure that translational material is available, and live 24/7 translation services in case we run into those needs. Dietary requirements, being very aware of the cultural backgrounds of individuals, the types of foods and things like that they would need, whether they're indigenous in nature or et cetera. The third would be understanding their spiritual requirements, and so whether they need elders or imams or priests, making sure that those sorts of services are available to them. So those are the foundational elements. Then we really are looking at the development of individual plans for each client. So we didn't take an educational approach as much as we took a professional documentational approach. So what is it that we're going to, what is it that Kareem needs when he's facing a particular challenge or crisis? What is his individual plan? And so we develop an individual care plan for each person in our care. Mm-hmm. And so that's the model that we have used to try and respond to the needs of individuals and their cultural requirements.
And have you got feedback?
Yeah, no, I think we have. We have gotten spectacular feedback at the foundational levels. Those are the things that people are quite visible to them and they respond to. We have ongoing need to continue to work on the individual plans. There are times when that has worked very well, and it's about the value of that personal relationship between the client and the clinician. And there are times that it hasn't worked quite as well. And so we can need to continue to try and educate our clinicians and make sure that they follow the protocol that's required by those plans.
Relationships. Yes, we had another question here, or comment, or offering.
My name's Manu Sioni from Emerge Aotearoa.
You win.
I should win. I just wanted to say that in terms of that answer to the question, one of the things that we find is that when you have an organisation that incorporates the cultural and the clinical, you get an organisation that has an open mind, that it's not shut down to one way of doing things, that it looks at, actually, culture can be just ethnic culture, but it could also be other types of culture, like LGBTI. And so when you start to get your staff and your services working in an open-minded way, then they start to listen more, I think, rather than direct back to the service user tangata whai ora. Kia ora.
Thank you.
Kia ora.
Yes, sorry.
Talofa lava, Monique.
Talofa, Sean.
Kia ora, maloa lele, kia ora ana bula vanaka, whakalofa, lahi ata, malo ne, talofa
kutu. Hey!
So to make this a learning experience, I spoke to Carla because I was really interested in when you're speaking to somebody from Canada who have 680 different groups, including the Inuits and the First Nation people and the Métis, etc. You've got really diverse. So how do you try to be respectful to 680 different groups? So in Canada, there's an assembly of the First Nations, so it means that national organisations have a group where those diverse groups are represented, and therefore national organisations can connect with them, but also there's representation of those nations at the provincial or state level, so that organisations that are not working nationally in Canada can have an organisation to connect with, so that they can consult with them and make sure that their organisations are working most appropriately. And
does that filter down into those individual relationships that we were talking about? Hi.
Hi there. I'm probably not the best person to speak on this. I think we have some other...
You're the best person right now.
So I think it one of the things that we're encouraged to do in the Canadian context is really to connect in at the level that we're operating. So if you're working in a grassroots community organization, you would be connecting at that local or community level. If you're working at sort of a national policy perspective, you would be connecting in, as Sean was mentioning, at some of the national assembly organizations.
Okay. Did I see another hand? We'll come to another if I can. So another hand there. Am I missing someone? Let me know if I am.
I wrote it down. Hang on.
No pressure.
Kia orana.
Yeah, kia rana. Well done.
Kia rana. Is that better?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you. Hello. First of all, what a challenge we have here in Australia. Thank you for sharing the fact that 280,000 Pacifica are now living in Australia. We've got a lot of work to do, I think. For us at our table, it's very brief, but I think we can't even begin to understand the different perspectives around mental health, mental
just bring the mic up a bit, yeah.
Well-being, etc., unless we listen. So the key message for us is that we need to be ready to listen and be taught at the very least.
So what do you think you might do next?
For me, I think the biggest challenge in our
like next week
back home in Murrumbidgee yeah. is learning more about this particular population. We're a big rugby league community for a start, so I know our rugby league teams are filled with Pacifica.
Yeah.
I don't believe our organisation is doing enough, so that's our first challenge, is to get to know who our community leaders are, see if we can't start forging some connections and start to learn about their experience in Australia and in our communities.
Because the rugby league here looked far and wide and they found you. Why did they go seeking you?
There was no organisation across Australasia or the South Pacific that was focusing on Pacific wellbeing, basically.
And the rugby proportion of Pacifica players in the rugby league are
48% the NRL elite athletes are Pacific. Yeah.
So they recognised that they weren't meeting the needs of their players properly.
Yeah, that, absolutely. And worldwide, they're actually leading in the mental health space, the NRL. And you may have noticed over the last few years, you know, they've had a decrease in alcohol incidents in the newspapers. They've had, you know, when there has been a couple of death by suicides, they've had some, you know, responses that have been first class.
So, Monique, over to you, because you referenced, someone mentioned connecting with elders in a community. Now you're going to connect with the other end of the spectrum, young'uns.
That's right. So working with young Pacific people in suicide prevention has really taught us a lot about how and what to compromise, but still retain quality of our 3C approach. And that's what I really wanted to look at is what are we prepared to compromise? Not just when we work cross-culturally, but when we work with young people. And we have the honour of leading New Zealand's Pacifica Suicide Prevention Program, named FLOW. It's part of Waka Hauora, the New Zealand Māori and Pacific National Suicide Prevention Program that we implement with Te Reo Matatini. And it's called FLOW. And the aim of the FLOW program is to equip Pacifica people and their families with the right knowledge, skills, knowledge and skills to prevent suicide and know how to respond if it occurs. So FLOW is a very bottom-up community action approach, which makes sense given that most of our death by suicides are outside of the healthcare system. So it's just an important point to note, because if we know that, our approaches to preventing suicide might be a little bit different. And I need to acknowledge the Ministry of Health here in New Zealand, for recognising that suicide is an ethnically disproportionate issue. And I won't go into the stats or all the program, it's all on our website, but suicide is the leading cause of death for Māori and Pacific young people between the ages of 15 and 24. So the first project that I wanted to share with you, we were tasked with designing a culturally relevant education program that focused on the risk and protective factors for Pacific families and communities. And the idea was to train community champions, not so much gatekeeper training, but just equipping people with tools and knowledge to educate their own communities in their own languages on how to identify risk, know what to do, and when to refer. So we wanted a toolkit, we designed and developed a toolkit, we wanted it as standardised as possible. So there was no room for misunderstanding, there was no room for confusion and mixed messages, and we really wanted to retain the fidelity of the knowledge exchange. So, and we knew there's high demand for this in our communities because some of the mainstream gatekeeper training programs, they thought were not doing it for them. So when it came to developing the learning set of the toolkit, that was about Pacific youth suicide. Our young people that we were co-designing with, they just had absolute clarity on what they wanted. And they didn't want to talk about friends or bullying, or they didn't want to talk to their peers. They didn't want to talk about social support or depression. They just wanted a targeted, clear message direct to their parents. And because suicide is tapu or sacred, the nature of it, you know, talking about suicide in Pacific communities, there's no research on safe talking in Pacific communities around suicide. We weren't that keen to have such a challenging and confrontational approach that our young people wanted, particularly towards our elders. And so this was a, you know, we were in a bit of a conundrum. After much debate, we compromised and we trusted our leaders who with lived experience. And so we made this video. And it took 3 months, quite a lot of drama, I have to say, but it took 3 months. Pacific clinical psychologists were supervising, and all the young people in this video have lived experience. They based it on a video they already saw somewhere in Europe, I think. And what they wanted to do was just send a message direct to their parents on what to look out for in them, what are the warning signs, and what do you do about it. And I really just want to acknowledge the people in the room today who may have lost a loved one or who have lived experience. This video is completely safe, but it may bring up some emotions.
I have my ups and downs, just like anybody else.
Maybe more than anybody else.
I can be hard to figure out.
And I like my privacy.
I don't want you checking up on me all the time.
But you know your family better than anybody else. So if you think they're acting different...
Acting really down, crying all the time for no good reason.
Or getting really mad.
Not able to sleep, or sleeping too much.
Shutting their friends out, giving their stuff away.
Acting reckless, drinking, using drugs, staying out late.
Suddenly not doing the stuff they used to love.
Or doing things that is just not like them.
It may be nothing to worry about. It may be just high school.
Or it may be something more. They may be depressed.
Not just feeling down, but really, really sad.
It might be that your kid is thinking about killing themselves.
It happens. More than you think. More than it should.
And people say, I had no idea.
I thought it was just a phase they were going through.
I never thought she'd do it.
I wish he had come to me.
I wish he had said something.
I wish I'd said something.
Even if I seem okay, or say I'm okay.
Ask anyway. Don't give up on me.
I may be really good at hiding my feelings.
I don't want to make a big deal.
If you think your kids are acting different, or if they seem like a different person, say something.
Say, what's up? Let's talk about it.
Don't shame me by asking in front of others.
Give me a chance to find the words.
Let me calm down.
Give me a chance to gather my thoughts.
Be straight up and ask.
It doesn't hurt to ask. In fact, it helps.
When people are thinking about suicide, they want somebody to ask.
They want somebody to care.
Maybe you think you'll make it worse if you ask. Like you're putting the idea in their head.
Believe me, it doesn't work that way.
In fact, the best way to keep teenagers safe is to ask. Are you thinking about killing yourself?
And what if they say yes?
Or maybe.
Or sometimes.
Well, here's what you don't say.
Don't be selfish.
Don't be so dramatic.
Get over it.
That boy's not worth killing yourself over.
Go on then, do it.
You just want attention.
If you don't do it, I'll do it for you.
Are you trying to bring shame to the family?
What you do is listen and then say.
I'm sorry you're feeling so bad.
How can I help?
We'll get through this together.
Let's keep you safe.
A lot of people think about suicide.
Most won't try, but some will. If you hear someone say things like,
I'd be better off dead.
Life's too hard now.
Take them seriously. Find someone they can talk to about it. Someone who knows how to help.
Sometimes kids want to kill themselves because something has happened. A breakout, bullying, or failure to meet expectations.
But sometimes it goes deeper and it's not going to go away by itself.
Get some help. Talk to someone you trust.
Try the helplines or websites for more information.
Or your church leaders or school counselors.
Don't just let it drop.
Make sure your kid always has someone to talk to. Someone they trust.
Make a list together. Right there. 3, 4, 5 names of support people.
Put the suicide helpline number on there too.
Make sure they keep it on them.
Make sure your home is safe.
Lock away pills, get rid of weapons or anything they may use to hurt themselves with.
And one more thing, don't leave them alone.
If you feel you can't keep them safe, call 111.
If your loved one tells you they want to end their life, be brave.
Be calm and breathe.
Reassure them. Allow them to talk.
Validate their feelings.
Ensure their safety.
No matter how small their problem seems to you, it's a big deal to them.
It never hurts to ask.
And it can make a big difference.
Or the difference.
In your kid's life.
So I'm really glad we compromised some of our policies and procedures and structures, and we went with those leaders on that video. The video was always intended as an educational resource, as part of the toolkit, so that's why it's quite long, but we found it was safe enough to put online and now it's gone viral. The NRL have it on their website. 10 or 11 tertiary institutions in New Zealand and the South Pacific use it as part of their medical school or wellbeing curriculum. And we've lost count of how many people view it or we've given it to on Datastick. So we're really happy we did that. And I guess overall, what I'd like us to break out into groups soon after I show you the next resource is like, what do you think you need to compromise to work cross-culturally just for better outcomes? And, you know, taking that leap of faith sometimes and going with your gut instinct. But just quickly, I wanted to show you the next resource, and it's called Auntie D. And Auntie D is an online problem-solving tool targeted for Māori and Pacific young people between the ages of 14 and 25. And she guides the user to identify problems, generate solutions, and then act. She doesn't provide the answers. It's very self-reflective. And at the end of the process, the people have a plan that they can download and email to themselves. I'm going to talk quite fast because we're running out of time, but basically there's lots and lots of evidence for it. We know that structured problem solving through cognitive behavioural therapy has been shown to be effective for reducing symptoms of depression in adolescents, but also really promising practice for suicide prevention. And I think WHO has done some trials and agree with that as well. I'm not going to go into that. What have I got next? We co-designed this over a year and a half, 18 months, with young people across New Zealand, and we went through this big co-design process, and I don't know if people are accustomed to co-design, but it's quite a long process, and it can be quite conflictual, that I found with these young people. So you build test, you have a prototype, and you build, test, repeat, build, test, repeat, build, test, repeat, and it's not a case of build and they will come, it's inclusive and iterative development process. But It was the seeing the end users as expert that really helped this be the best app it could be. They wanted it to be able to use it anywhere, anytime, which means it's not limited to a single platform or device. It needed to be a web-based app that works on smartphones, tablets, and desktops. So there's no big apps to download, and it doesn't use up precious storage space on their phones or use precious data. The iOS or Android apps, they say, is just a big barrier. They don't like them. And they also told us, yes, it's great, they want to solve their own problems, but we must have some solutions on our website as well that they can use. So there's lots of tips and tricks that Auntie D can give them. And just in terms of safety, we have a word match function where if somebody types in something around suicide or self-harm or violence, up pops. Auntie D sort of says, I see you're not feeling too well, and they go straight through to the helplines. And we're just at the back end trying to organise, not just that they have to dial a number and talk to someone, but that if we can have a warm referral to an actual auntie who happens to be a mental health nurse. So, and this tool's been really cool. It's intended for the general public, but people in hospitals and mental health services are using it as well, just with young people doing CBT, structured problem solving, on an iPad. And the cool thing is they can email it to their therapist, and that's your clinical notes done, and then they can email it to themselves, and they can email it to their parents, and so everybody works on that problem that week. We use it in team meetings when we can't agree. We're okay, let's talk to Auntie D, and we type it. So I think there's more uses than what it's just for. So is it working? Well, this is the bit where we did the compromise. So at the start and the finish of the problem solving, we ask how you're feeling, and it's just a simple thumbs up or thumbs down. At the back end, the data is a 7-point Likert scale. And we use that to measure sort of pre and post effectiveness of the problem solving process. And for those that have completed the whole process, which takes about 15 minutes on average, there's an average positive mood change of +1. So that's really good, and it also illustrates to the user that by changing the way we think, we can change the way we feel. But it was this measurement that was the biggest compromise we had to do of all. As a psychologist, you know, I thought we could have 11 different measures with emotions and characteristics at the beginning and the end, pre and post, and relevant, you know, standardised psychometrics. And apps, I have seen a lot of apps using the PHQ-9 and standardised tests like that at the beginning and the end. But the young people would just said, no way, it's really boring, and in fact it's a deterrent, I don't want to do it anymore, if I have to fill in that PHQ-9 again, I'm going to really need someone real to talk to. So we had to get rid of that, and that was a really big compromise for us because we know that if we don't get measured, we don't get funded. And although I have to say this app was hardly funded, it was mostly in-kind support. And so that basically we had to compromise funding in order to carry out this co-design process with authenticity. So we did, and it's just a thumbs up or thumbs down. So it was at that point that I didn't like the co-design process, and I felt like just changing the method. But really big compromise, personally, professionally, and as an organisation, but it's turned out to be, you know, really effective. So here's just a quick sneak peek at some of the results. Couple of thousand problems over a certain time period, and we can see that family relationships, work-related stress and sleep have some common problems that people are entering. And, you know, I've been in, sort of supporting research for about 20 years. I sit on funding committees and things like that. And what gets frustrating at the front line is that we can't use the evidence sometimes until 10 years after it's sort of done. And by that time, the kids are 30, so you kind of wonder if it's relevant. So this is really cool for us because we have a finger on the pulse of what problems are, how they're solving them, what they're doing. We can feed that back into our programs that we then supply to our own communities. Another interesting finding of this, which we're really happy about, is that 50% of the users are Pākehā, so of New Zealand European descent, when they fill in the first bit. So we're just so happy about that because the whole idea of having culturally relevant and robust tool tested only for Māori and Pacific young people has just turned that research paradigm upside down. And we've said, actually, sometimes if we get it right for the people who are most vulnerable, we might get it right for everybody. So we're really happy, and so everybody's using it and everybody's welcome to it. That was one thing that the young people also said, it has to be for free. So, and next week I'm really happy to announce that it'll be going out to every single high school in New Zealand. So the New Zealand government are starting to pick this up. Overall, we had a phenomenal amount of in-kind support for Auntie D, and lots of celebrity endorsement has really helped. So us Samoans, we have quite a different sense of humour. And Fafa Fine, the third gender in Samoa, the transgender, it's really well accepted. And we have this Samoan comedian in New Zealand called Auntie Tala, who's pretty famous over here actually as well. And he's got a show that you go on the show and you tell Auntie your problems, and he just makes jokes about you. So anyway, he had a message for this conference.
Hi, it's Auntie Tala here. Guess what? I want to introduce to you a very special friend of mine. Her name is Auntie D, spelled D-E-E. That's right, D-double-E. And it's an online well-being tool that can help you through difficult situations. If you are going through problems, it can help you solve this problem. It doesn't have the answers, but it will help you through any type of maybe bad situation that you might be in. Make sure you check out this app. Download it for free. It's for anybody and everybody. All thanks to the team from Levar, all my favorite. So make sure you check out on www.auntied.co.nz. Oh, you're gonna love it. Tell me about it. Bye.
So the question is, what are we prepared to compromise in order to get better outcomes across cultures?
Yes, now I'm going to let you take that question to morning tea. Can we thank Monique Faleafa?
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks.